Well, do you want to know all about Ghent? Ghent in Norfolk, one of my favorite neighborhoods in all of Hampton Roads. Well, that's what we're talking about today. The things I like, the things I don't like, and we're starting right now. Hey, my name is Sam Sansalone, and I'm a real estate agent in Hampton Roads, Virginia. And if it's your first time, so glad you made it. Hit the subscribe button, hit the bell notification. You'll get notified every time I do a video. I do them every week about Hampton Roads real estate, Virginia Beach, Norfolk, Chesapeake, all the cities that make up this area. And I love helping people move into this area. So today we're talking about Ghent in Norfolk. This is one of my favorite neighborhoods. There's so much architecture in here, so much unique stuff in here. So we're gonna get into all the things about Ghent. We're gonna talk about school district, restaurants, places I love to go to in Ghent, real estate, all the neighborhoods in here. And then we'll get into the history about Ghent because it's so thick with history. And also some things I don't like about Ghent, because there are some specific things that if you do move here, there will be some detractors and that might make your life frustrating. So I'll talk about all those things and give you a good balance as far as what it's like to live here. Well, first, where did the name come from? Well, James Moran, this is a guy that owned this property, Ghent, back in 1810. Time frame wise, this is right before the War of 1812. When the War of 1812 finalized in the end of 1814, the treaty that was signed in Ghent, Belgium. Well, James Moran named Ghent after where this treaty was signed. And before then, it was called Pleasant Point. And there are some other similar stories as to where the origination of the name came from, but this seems to be the closest and most likely story. And one interesting thing I'll mention is in 1855, a ship came from the West Indies, and on that ship also came a lot of mosquitoes. And those mosquitoes brought yellow fever over to Norfolk and killed about a third of the Norfolk population. Well, a lot of these people, when they passed away, they was like, there's so many people, where do we bury them? So they were actually buried, a lot of these were buried in this little park on Hampton Boulevard called the Yellow Fever Park. And there wasn't much attention paid to it until a Girl Scout troop put a commemorative plaque in the middle of this park so it commemorates the summer of this time when so many people passed away. And it's one thing that I think a lot of people in Hampton Roads don't know and never even heard of. And then this area developed with lots of diverse architecture and architecture that derives back from that time period. Incredible houses, huge houses, lots of European design. We'll talk a lot about this real estate later on in the video. But several decades ago, a lot of this area was run down, so some of this area was rebuilt. And so what is now known as Ghent Square, which we'll talk about Ghent Square and where that is in relation to the rest of Ghent in a second. But the growth and development of this area really started in the late 1800s when most of these houses were built and commuted between Ghent and downtown Norfolk by streetcar. But the construction and design of this area in Ghent included a lot of trees, lots of green space. That's something that I think is very important and it's very hard to find in Hampton Roads. Even if you don't live in Ghent, it's nice to go out of your way to walk in Ghent and experience how different it is between this area and the rest of the Norfolk area and Hampton Roads in general. And it's incredibly historic. It's now listed on the National Register of Historic Places as well. And there's lots of information and papers written about all the history in Ghent that would fill up so many videos. So I'll drop some links below so you can get more into detail if this is interesting to you, because I love this area. Now I want to specify where Ghent really is. It's not that big of an area. If you look on the map, you'll see that basically starts at the Llewellyn Avenue area near Granby Street and goes west all the way over to Hampton Boulevard. On the south side, the downtown area of Norfolk kind of creates the low south barrier of Ghent, and then goes up north to, there's some railroad tracks just north of 21st Street. That's kind of the northern barrier. So it's that whole square there. Not very big, but in these streets are loaded with amazing houses. If you go straight over Hampton Boulevard further west, you get to West Ghent. That is different than what we're talking about in this video. And I did a video about West Ghent specifically that I'll put up here so you can see more about that area. But this is all from Hampton Boulevard going east. Now we'll talk about real estate, because this kind of goes right hand in hand with the history. The houses that are built in this area are very, very typical to the time period and style that they were trying to go for in the late 1800s and then going into the early 1900s. There are some incredible two, three-story houses, amazing sizes, 2,500 square feet up to like 6,000, 7,000, sometimes 8,000 square feet, incredibly high ceilings, wide rooms, real spacious, ornate. They're like nothing else in the area. Look at these streets. The trees are thick. You feel like you're walking through a quiet neighborhood, but it's really, really close to downtown Norfolk. You don't even see that you're that close to it. If you love old architecture, English Tudors, colonial style, Victorian, large porches, this is perfect for you. Now, in addition, these houses start as low as, I mean, you could find them as low as $350,000, $400,000. There are a couple newer construction areas in the Ghent Square area that you can get. They're smaller, like 1,500 to 2,000 square feet, which is nice if you want to be in Ghent. This Ghent Square area was basically torn down and rebuilt back in the 60s, 70s, and 80s. But the true Ghent house that I'm talking about, 2,500 square feet, 4,000 square feet, 6,000 square feet, those are starting anywhere as low as the mid fours, going up to 800,000, up to maybe a million plus. But the meat range, I'd say 500 to 800,000 is the price range that you're talking about. There are lots of attached houses too. Row houses that start anywhere from like the 350, 400 range going up to 500, 600, 700,000 and higher than that. But condos, there are condos, apartment style, that start in the one bedroom, 500, 600 square foot range, goes up to 2, 3 bedrooms and more, but the fees often are pretty high. Not all the time, but just check those when you see the prices. The prices might look low, that's because the fees might be extremely high. And in or around these neighborhoods, Ghent Square specifically, are lots of green space. This is one thing that makes Ghent so unique, is that there are lots of houses and neighborhoods all together, but then there's lots of breaks in the action where you've got a block or two of park or yard, just wide open space. Which is one thing that people often ask me about when they're trying to find a place to live. They love the idea of being close to parks. Well, if you're okay with the style of houses that are around here and you want to be walking distance to parks, this might be a good option for you. Now, I'm going to talk more about the things I don't like about Ghent later in the video, but one thing I'll mention now that's relevant to the real estate is that if you want a house in Ghent, it is very hard to find a house that has lots of backyard. You see, the houses are very close together and you got a lot of condos. So because of all this, the green space in your actual property is very hard to come by. So if you do have that, the value of the property does go up quite a bit and the demand is there for that. So otherwise, the fact that the green space is there near your house can often help and offset the fact that you might not have that in the property that you're buying. So if you're planning on getting a house like this, know that if you're getting like a 3,000, 4,000 square foot Victorian style house, you got a lot of things to think about that are different than like buying a house in Virginia Beach. All the electrical systems could be needing rewiring. Plumbing, the walls are extremely thick, which is awesome. The rooms are extremely high often too, so heating costs can be higher. So there are costs that are associated with living in these kind of types of houses that might not be the type of thing that you like, but if you love these houses, and you're willing to pay the extra amounts for this lifestyle, there is nothing that beats it. Now I wanna talk a little bit about just what it's like to live in Ghent. I used to live in Ghent myself for a while before I got married, and it's one of the most unique places you can live, especially in the entire Hampton Roads area. There's nothing like it. Take everything that you think about with Virginia Beach, Chesapeake, and throw it out. And it's won multiple awards. The American Planning Association, they do a thing called the Great Places in America, and it's one of the 5 great neighborhoods they listed in 2018. And in 2015, the APA also gave it the People's Choice Award for Best Neighborhood as well. You've got access to restaurants. There's amazing restaurants on a couple streets specifically called Collie Avenue and Colonial Avenue. So that's where most of the people you'll find walk up and down, bike, stop for a bite to eat. And the third street is 21st Street, that is close to the northern border of Ghent and goes east and west. A lot of restaurants on this street also, some of my favorites. I'll mention a couple now. Mr. Shawarma is on 21st Street. They have awesome Mediterranean gyros. And there's another restaurant I have that's one of my favorites too, called the Public House, which is on Collie Avenue on the south side. And then on Collie Avenue is a place called Strawberry Fields, which isn't a restaurant. It's a smoothie place that we go to as much as we can too. And it's a real small place, you walk right up to it. Now across from there is a fun place called The Narrow. It's The Narrow Cinema. That's an old, old theater that's been restored. They show sometimes independent films, some films that you don't expect to see in other theaters you can see here. The culture is very unique here compared to other places. So it has a very vintage vibe to this area. Me and my wife love going to Cafe Stella, which is a coffee place on Colonial Avenue. But then on Collie Avenue, which I think is our favorite, is Fairgrounds Coffee, which has awesome tea too. So even if you don't live in Ghent, you can make a day of it. Just park your car in Ghent, go for a walk through the streets, get a bite to eat, go down to the water. And if you live in this area, oh my gosh, like, can you imagine how awesome this is? If you want to take a walk down to the Tyne, which is the light rail in Norfolk. You can do that and go to the rest of Norfolk. Hit a baseball game in downtown Norfolk. You can go to a nice show where the Chrysler Museum is. It's in Ghent also, which is one of the best art museums in the area. You can walk over and get a bite to eat on Collie Avenue or Colonial Avenue, which is like the heart, I would say, of Ghent. You can walk down to the area that I love. It's called The Hague. The Hague is in the very front, the south section of Ghent, but it faces, it's near downtown Norfolk. Well, when you look down, go down to the bottom of Ghent, there's a semicircle. And that semicircle borders a little body of water that's near downtown Norfolk. Well, that's where the Hague is. Now, on that semicircle, there are streets lined with houses, large houses like the ones I've mentioned before. Those are overlooking the water, and you can walk to downtown 5 minutes or so, and you're a block or two away from the Chrysler Museum, that art museum. Then you can also go 5 minutes north and walk over to Colonial Avenue and Collie Avenue. Some of these are majestic, but the views, there's bridges, there's walkways that line around the water, as well as some park areas too you can walk through. So it's great for runners, great for walkers, great for people that just want to enjoy the outside and also be close to lots of action. A couple side things I'll mention too is that you're actually in the same area as the large Sentara Heart Hospital and CHKD, which was just recently built, and EVMS, Eastern Virginia Medical School, which is in this area too, all kind of in the same southwestern corridor of Ghent. Now, school districts, I want to talk about this because if you do move to Ghent, this is something to keep in mind. There are some specific school districts. Maury High School is the high school district here, and Blair Middle School is the middle school. Now, there are a couple elementary schools. There's Ghent Elementary, then there's Walter Heron Taylor Elementary, but they're not as highly ranked. I mean, they're not bad, but if you look at niche.com, you'll notice that where they are ranked in relation to the rest of the area. So you'll notice some people also choose private school. There are several private schools that people usually choose if they live in this area too. Norfolk Academy, Norfolk Collegiate, and Norfolk Christian are three that are in Norfolk on the north or northeastern side of Norfolk that people often choose, as well as Ghent Montessori. Now, shopping, like grocery stores, if you do live in this area, there are a couple, well, now there's three that I think are most notable. The first one was Harris Teeter that is right in the middle of Ghent. I used to walk to this Harris Teeter. It was right down the street from my condo. But then there's also Fresh Market that is on the northwestern side of Ghent that's just kind of tucked away. It's not really as convenient. But then there's also Aldi, which is on the north side also. So part of the allure of living in Ghent can be the idea of walking from place to place. Well, one of the downsides to being in Ghent is that while you can walk from place to place, the access to grocery shopping specifically is not as easy unless you go to that Harris Teeter. The Fresh Market's close enough to where it's there, but you may have to drive there. So the actual walking distance part is not as easy. So here's what I don't like about Ghent, and this is important if you plan on living here. Number one is the flooding. Now, I've mentioned in other videos about flooding, the western part of Norfolk has an issue with this. There are a lot of people, lots of money being put towards trying to figure out the best way to mitigate the flooding issues in this area. On the western side and going to the west and northwestern side of Norfolk, there is slowly rising water levels, and some of the houses that were built in this area are pretty close to sea level. Then there are some specific areas that form very small bowls where with a huge downpour or really a large storm, specific areas in Ghent can flood. And so when I say flood, this means that the streets can be very hard to navigate. So it's very important to know where your car is parked and how high off of the street level you can park. The higher you can park, obviously the better, but navigating from place to place, even in Ghent, can be extremely difficult and sometimes very treacherous. If a big enough storm or like a tropical system comes through, the waters can rise pretty quickly. As you notice, the houses are built up off the road just enough to where I'm not as worried about the houses themselves right now. It's more of just the parking situation and walking situation. That could change over time, but for now, that's what I'm most focused on. That leads me to the next thing I don't like, which is the parking. Oh my gosh. Parking signs everywhere. Where can you park? Can't park here. You gotta park here. Between this time and this time, you can park over here, but not this time and this time. Oh, but then you can't park over here. Park across the street for this time. There are so many places where it's like, do I even know if I can park here for the next hour? It's really frustrating, guys. It doesn't, forget the flooding aspect of it. It's just the fact that parking on the street, while it's very doable, like you can park there, it's not, you're not gonna pay for parking. But the fact of it is that there are so many rules and hoops to jump through to figure out which spots you can park in. You could say, hey, Sam, the signs tell you where you can park and where you can't. I know, I get it. But there are some signs that make sense. It just says no parking. Or it'll say like no parking between this time and this time. Okay, thanks. Then there'll be others that'll say no parking except during this time. But you have to make sure you read the sign to make sure you know which one it is. Because what happens is there are street sweepers and cleaners that go up and down some of these streets and they do it in specific days. So you have to sometimes park your car on one side of the street during one part of one day because they're gonna clean the streets on the other part of the street. Then if you want to, you can move the car back to where you originally parked for the rest of the week. But in some spots, you have to make sure you don't park your car in the places where they're cleaning because they will ticket you. I've had it happen to me. So the whole fiasco with the parking mixed in with the idea that you can't park everywhere and avoid flooding issues makes it quite complicated. Now it's doable. People live here and love it here. But if you plan to move here, check to make sure you know where you can park, how easy is it to get from where your car is to where your house is. And if you do buy a house in this area, see if there are any parking spaces off the road, because that can really help you, because often the parking spaces are up and they're away from the street. So it solves both problems. Now clearly, people live in this area and have done this for decades and know this is a problem. So it's not something that's pushing people away necessarily, but it's something that if you want to move into this area, know this before you come in, because it will more than likely influence your day-to-day life in some capacity. I help so many people from around the world move into this area. It's awesome. And so if you have any questions about moving into this area, let me know as soon as you can. I will do whatever I can to help you. I'll drop my contact information in the description below, and you can get a hold of me anytime you need to. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next video.